I tripped over that a little bit.
But I can tell you're cracking up. You're like, this.
Yeah, I know.
I actually see what he's doing there.
I know. I see where this is going. Yeah. I mean, but I think that'll play out fine.
I always love, though, you're like, that you're surprised by terrible puns. Like, it's great.
Well, no, I think it'll work, particularly like the second one, because I think I might have turned it up a little too much for the last dot. But here we go again. Welcome to Two Designers Walk Into a Bar.
A place where pop culture creatives
discover design icons that make us tick.
And we share a few cocktails in the process.
Yep. Nothing sets the stage quite like title design.
Today we explore two different examples of amazing work that went above and beyond to get viewers excited about each episode of a TV series.
So make sure your streaming accounts are paid up, the popcorn is popped, and you have the right amount of rum to coke, because it's time once again to take a seat at the bar.
Okay, Todd, so let's jump into this. We're talking titles for television series. Now, You know I have professed my love of The Dukes of Hazzard and that opening title sequence when we were discussing the hobo typeface. So
that's true.
We can't trod back over that well-worn ground again.
No.
As much as we would love to.
There has to be at least one more that you really like.
I thought about it. And I think we have to go a little bit deeper than the Brady Bunch. That would be my other favorite.
Okay.
Yeah. So I wanted to talk today about a show called Carnival. Now, Some listeners may have seen the show. Others may have heard of it. Some folks, I'm sure have never seen it because it's not a new show. In fact, it's close to 20 years old. So what I would like to do is talk a little bit about this show, and then I can start to jump into the titles and why I feel they were so great. Because I think they're great technically and visually, they're amazing, but they also really weave into the spirit of the show itself, which is just amazing.
Elliot, was Carnival, was that on a network or was that on a paid platform?
Yeah, so it was on HBO. Yeah.
Okay, I've got a show that also will be on HBO, so this would be great to compare these.
Okay. Yeah, so I guess you and I both are willing to shell out whatever the extra $10 a month is for for better TV credits.
But I've not seen Carnival, so I'm eager to learn more about it.
Yeah. So let me just, at a very high level, just tell you what it was all about, like who was responsible for it. But then I feel... like I said a second ago, we need to get into the show. Otherwise, what I'm going to describe is not going to make a lot of sense. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So this title sequence was created by a shop in Southern California called A52. So A52 is a visual effects and design company in Los Angeles. And in addition to the very rich visuals, there was this amazing music from Wendy Melvoin and Lisa Coleman. So they were the musicians for this episode.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so then you definitely have piqued my interest, Elliot, because you know where Wendy and Lisa came from, right? You know how they got their start.
It wasn't Carnival?
Well, no. They were hired by His Purple Highness.
They were
close associates to Prince, and they were part of Prince and the Revolution, and great, great musicians, great musical families, still very productive today. But I didn't know that they did the Carnival opening. So now you really got my interest piqued.
Yeah. Now, before you were on the fence, right?
Well, I was really going to watch it anyway, but now that I know that Wendy and Lisa were involved.
Okay, that was just the cherry on top of the sundae. Got it.
Absolutely.
Okay, so let's get into the show really, really quick. And then we can start to unpack some stuff here. And I assume that Prince also was not a secret ghostwriter on this show.
Well, who knows? I haven't heard that. So
that's right. Well, we'll see. Let's see what memories get sparked here. Okay. So this show was on HBO between 2003 and 2005. And the production values of this show were absolutely incredible. A lot of digital effects, and I'll explain. You know, it was set during the Dust Bowl, so they had to really have all these sort of effects of that time period. There was also magic involved, so naturally there were some special effects there as well. And at the time, if my memory serves me correctly, it had the largest per episode budget of any show on television at $4 million per episode.
Whoa.
Yeah. So Whoa. Keep in mind, that was close to 20 years ago, and it was $4 million an episode. And that wasn't going into the actors' pockets. That was going into mostly, I think, the production of this show. So HBO
was only owned for 2 years?
Yes. And wow. I'll yeah. So it was supposed to be 6 seasons. It was the creator had come to this idea of there were going to be 3 books, and each book would be 2 seasons long. But the problem is it was very expensive to produce well. Mm. And over time, because it was really it wasn't a show you could jump into the middle of and start tracking with the storyline.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So and you got to keep in mind, at the time, you couldn't binge watch like you can now. There was no Netflix. There was no Hulu. So if you didn't catch this on HBO, either when it debuted or as a rerun, or, you know, occasionally there'd be like a marathon or something, it was very difficult to catch up to what was going on. Okay.
Hmm.
So, so we'll get a little bit more into that in just a little while. So as I started to mention a minute ago, the 2 seasons of Carnival that were produced, they take place in the Depression era Dust Bowl between 1934 and 1935. Okay. And there are 2 plot lines that happen and then start to converge over the arc of this show, okay? So the first one involves a young man named Ben Hawkins, who is played by Nick Stahl, and he has these strange sort of healing powers. And he joins a traveling carnival when it passes near his home in Milfay, Oklahoma. So again, we're talking Dust Bowl. We're talking the Great Plains. So there is nothing keeping this guy in this town, right? Soon thereafter, Ben begins having these surreal dreams and visions, which set him on the trail of a man named Henry Scudder, who is a drifter who crossed paths with the carnival many years before, and who apparently also possessed some unusual abilities that were similar to Ben's. Okay? Hmm. So there's a lot to unpack here, and that's only the first of the 2 plot lines. Okay? I haven't even talked about the second one yet. Yeah. So I hope you're taking really, really good notes as I'm talking.
Okay. I'm trying to follow along.
Yeah. Okay. You have your yarn and your thumbtacks and your photos and your bulletin board, right? You're plotting
exactly.
all this out.
Yeah,
okay.
Exactly. Okay. I got my protractors and everything.
Yeah. Okay. And then the second plot line revolves around a character named Brother Justin Crow, played by Clancy Brown, who a lot of folks will know as the head guard in Shawshank Redemption, right? So that gives you an idea of sort of the gravitas of this figure, right? So he's this Father Coughlin-esque Methodist preacher. He lives with his sister Iris, who is played by Amy Madigan. Again, this show is so well cast. And they are in California, so they are west of where Ben is in Oklahoma. However, he shares Ben's prophetic dreams and slowly discovers the extent of his own unearthly powers, and those include bending human beings to his will and making their sins and greatest evils manifest as terrifying visions. So he thinks, however, that this isn't evil. He actually thinks he's doing God's work, right? He was anointed with these abilities. So Brother Justin fully devotes himself to his religious duties, and he's not realizing that his ultimate nemesis, Ben Hawkins, and the carnival are inexorably drawing closer to him, you know, in California. All right. So very, very dense, very rich, very, very dense. Okay. So I've kind of given you an idea of just a handful of the characters, why there's this traveling carnival going around the geography, the time period, all these sorts of things. So Carnival's 1930s Dust Bowl setting required significant research and historical consultants to be convincing. But HBO, again, had the deep pockets to do this, as we talked about, $4 million an episode. Okay. So I want to give an idea of some of the extent to which they tried to make this authentic. Like, this is pretty incredible. Because that authenticity will then drip over directly into these opening titles. Okay.
Okay.
So to give a sense of the dry and dusty environment of the Dust Bowl, I mean, this is the Dust Bowl. Smoke and dirt were constantly blown through tubes onto the set, onto the actors, onto all the props, like, you know, just everything. So not an easy...
$4 million worth of smoke and dust and dirt.
Yeah, I hate to be the guy in craft services. You know, more potato salad, Ben? You know, poof. Then the actors' clothes themselves were ragged. They were always drenched in dirt. And the show had approximately 5,000 people costumed in it the first season alone. 5,000 people.
Whoa.
I mean, that's insane. And then to prepare for the production, the creative team listened to 1930s music. So we talked about the music a few minutes ago. The radio, we talked about Father Coughlin, you know, what was being broadcast across the country. And then they read old Hollywood magazines to get the period sound and language and slang all accurate, like the production of the time. The art department also did extensive research. Again, as we talked about with our books episode, Wikipedia really wasn't around. We didn't have access to all the stuff we have now. We didn't have iPhones in our pockets where we could just look something up if we weren't sure. So these guys had to go out and find old catalogs. And among them, they found an original 1934 Sears and Roebuck catalog. And so they were looking at this for what would have been available to these guys at the time in this part of the world. And so they were going to flea markets, they were going to antique stores, and they were looking for all these things that were very period specific. And then aside from the show's supernatural elements, they actually got a historical consultant to look at everything. And they said, what do you think of this? And apparently this person said the accuracy was spot on in terms of how the characters were living their lives, what their wardrobe was like, the types of things they ate, the types of places they lived, the vehicles they drove, and just the stuff they had, the belongings that they would have had at the time. You know, again, things that you would get in these little towns, things you could get through a Sears and Roebuck catalog. So, so they were really, really trying to be very, very accurate. And the reviews actually bore that out. Okay, so the reviews said things, there were superlatives like for the production design, it was impeccable, it was spectacular, and it was an absolute visual stunner. There were these visual effects that were done because, of course, there was some supernatural activity, right? So they had to accurately depict this stuff. Well, I say accurately. What they had to do was they had to make it look believable. You know, it couldn't be cartoony lightning or really terrible puppetry or any of these sorts of things. So naturally, when they could avail themselves of CGI, and this wasn't early CGI, but it wasn't nearly as advanced as it is currently.
Right.
So what started to happen here? I'll just whet your appetite as we prepare for the title sequence itself. So Carnival the Show, okay? In 2004, it won 4 Emmys for art direction, cinematography, costumes, and hairstyling. So going back to the investment, the amount of money that they put into everything, they were, you know, like I said earlier, it wasn't like going into some actor's pockets or anything like that. It was being borne out in what was being seen on the screen by the viewers. And talking about what's seen on screen, I'm going to whet your appetite. And then I want to get into your show that was also on HBO, okay? So the opening title sequence, also in 2004, won an Emmy for Outstanding Main Title Design. So that is going to be my cliffhanger, because you're probably going to know what they did and how they did it.
Okay. Oh, sounds cool. Well, you have sold it even more. And, you know, as you were telling that story, Elliot, I was thinking, Wow, you know, a period piece is difficult to do accurately. Obviously, they were swinging for the fences and wanting to do it in a way that would be most convincing. And when you're blending that period and that much dust and dirt, to also incorporate CGI where it doesn't appear fake has got to be a real challenge. So that is pretty... That's pretty interesting. Yeah, I can't wait to hear more. And as I said, I picked a show's opening credits that I absolutely love. And the show that I picked was also on HBO and also near that same time. It actually started a little bit earlier. And the show I picked started in 2001, and it's 6 Feet Under.
Oh, yeah. What a great show.
Yeah. A little bit about that. It was created and produced by Alan Ball for HBO. As I said, started in 2001, and it went to 2005. So the same time Carnival ended. And Alan Ball was just coming off the huge success of American Beauty, if you remember that, in 1999. He had written and directed American Beauty, which was also a great movie, heavily influential, and he had this idea of a family-run funeral home that was sort of the foundation of these kind of crazy stories. Death brought people together. And so he took his first draft to HBO and met with Carolyn Strauss, who was head of HBO programming at the time, and her quote was, you know, this is really, really good. I love these characters. I love these situations, but it feels a little safe. Could you just make it a little more fucked up? And Alan Ball said, that's not a note that you would normally get in Hollywood. And he thought, wow, that gave him the free range to go deeper and go a little darker and get a little bit more complicated. So hats off to HBO for saying push the work on that.
That's great.
And so in talking about the show, as you just said about Carnival, it was consistently high rated. 6 Feet Under was consistently at the top of many best of lists, such as Time, The Guardian, Empire. It won scads of awards, Emmys, Golden Globes, SAG Awards, Peabody Awards. Including for titles, it won Emmys. And the show, as I said, is about a family that runs a funeral home, and they go into a tailspin after the sudden death of the patriarch of the family, who was really the sort of lifeblood, if you don't mind the pun, of the funeral home. And as luck would have it, this patriarch, Nathaniel Fisher is his name. Mm-hmm. And I'm not giving anything away. He dies literally in the first 30 seconds of the first show. So it is the impetus for the show. He consistently comes back to visit members of the family to tell them they're doing okay or they're not doing okay or that things are wrong. And so that in itself is kind of a funny premise. And as I said, it was from Alan Ball, who did American Beauty, who had some of the same type of odd things that are beautiful, quirkiness. And 6 Feet Under fell in line with that because the show itself, it was about both the loneliness and the beauty and the quirkiness and the humor of death. Mm-hmm. And the opening titles are just metaphor rich in describing that. They were designed by Digital Kitchen out of Washington State. And the director was a guy named Danny Yout, who was then with Digital Kitchen. He now runs his own digital shop. But what's really cool is, and what struck me, is how the show's premise kind of gets introduced every week through the opening credits. And exactly the way you said before, this wasn't a time where you could binge watch everything. Mm-hmm. They released a new show every Sunday night, so you had to watch it then. And what I loved about this, and I'll describe the titles a little bit to you. The first thing we see is a black raven flying across this cloudless sky, and the color of the sky, it feels like it's wintertime. It's kind of grayish blue sky, but very isolated black raven flying across. The camera tilts down to a lone tree that's at the top of this grassy hill. So if you think about it, you've got sort of grayish blue rectangular shape at the top. You've got this kind of grayish green rectangular shape at the bottom connected with this tree. And it looks like a Mark Rothko painting to me.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why they use this tree is because that's a symbol of decomposition and rebirth. You've heard of the expression, the exquisite corpse,
yes,
where
yep,
the remains of something grows something else. And the head of Digital Kitchen at the time, a guy named Paul Mateus, said, just as everything we have was given to us by prior generations, then we return to the earth. So the tree metaphor worked. It starts with this tree, as I said, and it was shot all in Washington, near Lake Washington. And what's funny about that is they couldn't find any evergreen trees to use because it was the middle of winter in Washington and most trees didn't have leaves. They ultimately found one by a Seattle resident and they bought it for $400. And the tree is actually held up by wires in the graveyard scene, which you can't see. Obviously, they took those out. But this tree that is so iconic for this great show was dead and propped up when it was being used.
How big was it?
It was, you know, probably 25 feet. They found smaller ones. It was a type of holly bush that didn't grow very tall. And they happened to find one that was tall and went up and knocked on the door and asked the residents if they could buy it.
Mind if I dig up your front yard?
And, no, it wasn't. I don't even think it was dug up. I think it was just chainsawed down.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And then propped up with wires.
Oh,
and,
man. You know, okay.
Back in the Queen Anne Hill section of Seattle. So that's the That to me is
kind
really
of
funny.
Is you know only appropriate, I guess, a dead tree in a cemetery for
exactly talking about death, right? So I imagine that once they chainsawed it down, they had to be like, "All right, we got to commence to filming this really fast because this tree's not going to last."
Clock's ticking.
Yeah. Okay. So we pan down, we see the iconic tree at the top of the hill, and then you hear this ting of a musical hit. And in the foreground, there are these clutching hands that rise up into view and they separate kind of quickly. It's like ramped up speed. And then we cut to a shot of two hands rubbing together. It takes us a second to kind of realize that these are hands of a worker that are being scrubbed. And, you know, obviously the hands of a mortician to prepare a body. Then you see beautiful close-up shots of toe tags and gurney wheels and bodies that are fading into white, just really expressive cinematography that follows along with the music. And I'm going to actually talk about the music in just a second because, like you were saying with Carnival, the music to 6 Feet Under is wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
So along with these are metaphors for death. And Danny Yount said, which I thought was really interesting. I saw a talk that he did, and I'll post a link to that. And he said, we started with kind of the tried and true metaphors of death. And I had always resisted that because I thought I had to do something better, had to do something smarter. And he said, what I've learned is start there, start where you start, and then continue to challenge yourself. So don't get hung up on the idea of you couldn't think of a smarter metaphor for death. Put something in and then continue to revisit that.
Right, chip away at it.
Right, which is a great idea. And one of those metaphors that he used was a dying bouquet of lilies, which dies in ramped up speed, which is just, again, it's beautiful to look at and you know that it's dying. And obviously it's a metaphor for the death in the show, the beauty and the death in the show. So finally we get to the end. This is only about 90 seconds of an intro and we see a close up of the raven and we're back to the hill with the iconic wired up tree and the raven flies past and then as the raven flies past, the tree sprouts this taproot, kind of in the shape of a casket, a box, if you will, and the words 6 feet under fade up as the screen goes white, which leads into the episode.
And if I remember correctly, it's kind of subterranean, right? So you're Rothko, the tree, the roots are animated and it's kind of growing into the ground, and it's like brown soil, dark soil, the root is white, right? And
Right. So again, it's like, it's that, is it decomposed? Is it growth? But it forms a border around the logo, the show's logo, but it kind of alludes to a coffin shape, or at least a grave shape. So, you know, really simple, elegant, beautiful imagery. And one of the things that's also interesting is there's a director's cut for this, and we'll post this as well, because what Danny Yao wanted to do is, when the purpose of opening titles is to give credits, right?
Yeah.
So it has the stars and the cast and crew. And what he wanted was a little type effect to happen. He wanted them to slowly decompose and float away like ashes would.
I like that. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's really sweet. It's not overdone. It's beautiful. The type is very elegantly done. HBO chose not to use that version for the one that they went with because at the time we just had After Effects, and to create that every week when a crew could change, a cast member could change, was going to be really time prohibitive.
Yeah.
But yeah, again, the director's cut is will be posted, and you can see what that would look like. So I talked a little bit about the credits and given you some description of that. Obviously, there's a link that will show the importance of the music. And a friend of mine who owns an animation studio and does a lot of television broadcast design used the phrase one time that music is half the picture. And in this particular case, it definitely is. And Elliot, it sounds like it's the same with Carnival too. It sounds like the music is really supporting what the show is about. I want to hear a little bit more about that, and then I want to give you some kind of behind the scenes and reactions to 6 Feet Under.
Todd, do you think our listeners are digging this episode so far?
I don't know, Elliot. There's definitely something getting shoveled around.
Hey, I'll tell you what. Let's get the bartender to make us a couple of mudslides, and we'll see everyone back around the table in just a minute.
Hi, while we have your attention, if you want to learn more about us and the podcast, there are a few ways to do it.
Visit our website at twodesignerswalkintoabar.com. All of that is spelled out. No numbers.
Kind of a long URL, so do yourself a favor and bookmark it. Once you're there, you can find links to more information about the subjects in this episode, our episode archive, and information about both of us.
Wait, we do want people to visit, right?
And look for us on social media. You can find those links on our website as well.
And while we're at it, if you have a friend who you feel will dig on our rambling,
tell him or her what we're up to.
While we can't guarantee that they will remain your friend, we can guarantee that they will listen to at least 30 seconds of whatever episode you send them the link to.
That's being a little shameless.
And speaking of being shameless, it wouldn't be a proper ask if we didn't mention that if you like what you hear, you can also make a donation via our website. We have a Nigerian prince handling all transactions for us.
In fact, he told us to mention that we have stickers to mail to anyone who donates $10 or more. Are we done?
We're done.
We're done.
Just to wrap up what you were talking about really quickly, I was wondering if, and it sounds like Danny Yount went and shadowed, if I'm understanding correctly, a mortician for a day, or at the very least talk to them and ask them what they do over the course of the day, right? And I think that that knowledge really, really, as you mentioned earlier, helped maybe break into this more atypical approach to representing death and the ritual of death and what happens when someone dies, and just the profession and the customs around that. So I thought that that was really, really great that you included that.
And you think about, that I said, American Beauty, which Alan Ball was just coming off of. That movie also is really about just the beauty of everyday stuff. And that's what this opening credit is about. That's what the show is about. I wouldn't say it's always beautiful, but I would say it's dramatic and funny and it's black comedy, but it's about everyday stuff if you happen to run a funeral home.
And isn't Alan Ball British?
Yes, he is.
So I remember when American Beauty came out, he felt that he was able to sort of parody American suburban life because he was an outsider.
Right, right.
And I'm sure the same thing was true with the way American culture deals with death, and also the fact that this was a profession that I would say he's probably not intimately familiar with, unless maybe as, I don't know, a mortician in his family.
Yeah,
or
I don't
something.
Know.
Yeah. So I think, again, it's this idea of like the virtue of the outsider and like your take because of what you don't know and you have to go and sort of suss it out and be curious about it. It leads to, you know, maybe a little bit of a more interesting solution than, like you were saying, something that would just be more typical.
I think that's a good way to look at it. Yeah, I think that's a really good way to look at it. But you've described Carnival, but
yes.
I haven't heard about the opening credits yet. I've got, now, admittedly, I have a visual in my head just from the setup, and it sounds rich. It sounds like they spared no expense. So I'm excited to hear a little bit about how they introduced it weekly.
Yeah, so as we mentioned, it's a Dust Bowl era 1930s. There are people with supernatural powers. There's this authentic period look and feel. So let's talk a little bit about how this title sequence came to be and the brains behind the operation at A52. Okay, so this was a fellow named Angus Wall, and he's still working today, and I'll talk a little bit more about him.
Mm-hmm.
So he had a history of working for another motion graphics company prior to A52, and you may have heard of this company, Imaginary Forces. Does that ring a bell at all?
I've heard a little something about that. I hear they're going to do some good stuff one day.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe.
Yeah.
Let me give you a little bit of hope.
Okay.
So they gained a lot of notoriety when they did the titles for Seven, you know, the Brad Pitt,
yeah,
Kevin Spacey,
yeah,
movie Seven. They won. That really is what put them on the map.
Don't forget Gwyneth Paltrow, too, starring as the head.
Yeah,
the
yeah.
Sorry, I didn't mean to give that away either.
Yeah,
but.
Oh man, Todd, I mean, you're just tipping our hand. And speaking of tipping your hand, here's a few more things that this guy has gone on to do more recently. So sticking with HBO, he has worked on the titles for Game of Thrones, another little show HBO put together some people may have heard of.
I hear that's going to do well, too.
Yeah, I think it'll be okay. Then he's also been working with the director David Fincher on editing work. So, you know, not just motion graphics or title work, but he's done worked on The Social Network, Girl with a Dragon Tattoo, movies like that. Okay, so this guy obviously is steeped in just general, he has a great design eye, he understands narrative, you know, all these things that need to come together for these successful movie titles, right? Because it's about knowing and understanding the story, right? I think that's one of these common things that we start to pick up here. So he had three goals, one of which you actually alluded to earlier when you were talking about the titles for Six Feet Under. Okay,
mm-hmm.
So his goals all centered around three things the opening titles needed to deliver to the viewer quickly. So, the historic era in which the show was set, we've talked about that. The supernatural aura surrounding the mm-hmm. characters and the traveling carnival, we've talked a little bit about that. Okay, so far so good. Oh, and by the way, those dense storylines I mentioned,
mm-hmm.
we have to get people engaged enough with everything that's going on in 90 seconds. right? Over this
sounds doable. Yeah,
yeah. Like how
with
do we
magic,
go about
carnival
doing that?
Dust bowl? Yeah,
right. Yeah, the dirty people and the authentic stuff they own and everything
right.
else. Right. So how do you do that? If you were presented with that opportunity, what would you do? So this goes back to what I was saying a second ago about tipping your hand. So the opening title sequence itself begins with a deck of tarot cards.
Oh.
So if you think about something mystical, I mean, tarot cards are just one of these iconic props, right? We don't know everything about them, you know, just like playing cards or some of these other things. When you see tarot cards, you know what they are, and you generally know sort of the setting in which they're producing themselves, right?
Right.
So these tarot cards, a deck of tarot cards starts to fall into the sand, you know, against the dust bowl, right? So this sandy mm-hmm. background. This is when things very quickly start to get remarkable. So the camera, you as the viewer, the camera, the vantage point, moves in and starts to enter inside of one card, and a whole world opens up, presenting layers of artwork and footage from iconic moments of the American Depression era. Soup lines, building the Golden Gate Bridge, Jesse Owens and Babe Ruth, these iconic sports figures. Okay. So then the camera kind of backs up and sweeps out and moves into a different card, and it repeats this several times, and the viewer is there coming in and out of all these different layers within these tarot cards. And then the sequence ends with a camera shifting from the Judgment tarot card to the Moon and the Sun. And so that, of course, for people who know tarot and astrology and those sorts of things, so that's the Devil and that's God. Okay, so the tension between good and evil. Then the wind comes, again, it's the Dust Bowl, and blows all the cards away and the sand that had been resting underneath the cards. And the logo to the show, the carnival title, gets revealed. And so you had such a great quote that music is half the picture.
Right.
So while all of this is happening, this ominous and sort of American Gothic string and piano-based music is playing, and it is so well married to the visuals.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And the two of these things together really sets the tone for each episode of the show. And Angus Wall mentioned that each card represents a different element of this storyline that we've been talking about, right? So he not only was thinking about it at a very high level, but he was obviously talking to the creators, trying to understand what the intent was, and then really trying to provide these clues in these opening title moments. So it's really great, both visually, it's just beautiful, but then in terms of the meaning. And so it's very, very multi-layered. But when you look at it, and of course we'll have the link on our episode page, it is just lush and it is immersive, and it is, and I don't use this word often, but I think it is appropriate here, it is just gorgeous. It is absolutely gorgeous.
Wow.
Yeah. So again, the main goal, ground the viewers in the time frame of the show, the U.S. in the mid-30s. And it's a time, you know, global unrest. Fascism is on the rise in Europe. There's the Great Depression in the United States. So there's this devastating social and economic impact in cities all across the country. So they had to find archival footage that showed these things. Like, this is what's really amazing, is this isn't something that was created using actors or out of thin air. They're showing actual, you know, at the time, 80, 90-year-old footage. It's just wonderful. So this documentary footage also touches on the main theme of the show, the eternal conflict of good versus evil. They bolster this with famous works of art. Michelangelo's Last Judgment, an etching by Gustave Doré of an angel fighting a dragon, Raphael's Saint Michael vanquishing Satan. So it's exploring all these themes from a Christian and art historian perspective. Like, this is just so, there's so many layers of information here. And the more you watch it, the more this starts to reveal itself. So in a way, it's just as dense as the show itself, right?
Yeah. It sounds like the titles are like the Rosetta Stone for the show.
It really was. And of course, at the time, when you're watching the show, I mean, you don't know this, right? You know, there wasn't no one. All the series, the two seasons, hadn't all been produced yet. There wasn't any way to binge watch it. So it's not like someone was hopping on Netflix watching 12 episodes of this and saying, oh, man, yeah, these credits really add up. So it really had to pique the viewers' interest to keep them coming back. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, this was almost 20 years ago. You know, you mentioned After Effects and that HBO is kind of like we get this type effect you guys are trying to do, but you got to use this specific program, After Effects, and this is going to take a while and means we have to do unique titles for every show, you know, so obviously this deeper aesthetic got hung up at the time, right? Well, basically, this whole title sequence was nothing but effects like that. I mean, there was no, well, maybe can we compromise? Like if there was any sort of compromise, it really wouldn't have worked, right? So how did these guys do this? So I don't want to get too in the weeds with technical stuff, but basically it was like what you were talking about. It was Photoshop, it was some digital rendering, and it was compositing, you know, on whatever Macs or Avid systems or whatever they had at the time that they were using. But they were scanning transparencies of the famous pieces of art I mentioned. And each of these scans, because they had to go into these layers, the camera had to carry the viewer through these layers, each of these specific images was up to 300 megabytes in size. So again, you might say, well, that's no big deal. You know, I have these thumb drives in my desk drawer at work that are, you know, gigs or whatever. But I mean, to manipulate a 300 megabyte image was no mean feat, right?
Right, right. And yeah, to make it move, particularly at that time, machines had to be crazy powerful.
So they, you know, figured out a way, obviously, to do this. And then all the stock footage clips I mentioned earlier, they have things like Klan rallies. They have marches on Washington. All of these events I mentioned, like the Golden Gate Bridge or Jesse Owens at the Olympics. So they had to find all these stock footage clips. They had to compile them and then digitally incorporate them into this sequence, right? So all of this was very, very just, I can't even imagine the lift. Just the vision, first of all, but then pulling the pieces together to actually make this happen. Oh, and by the way, do it in 90 seconds.
right.
So, but they pulled it off. And I mean, again, we encourage every listener to please visit our episode page so that you can all just take a look at both of these works of art that we're talking about today because they are wonderful.
Yeah, exactly, Elliot. Now, you know, I think we owe HBO a giant thank you for allowing the artist for those shows as well as the opening credits to do what they do. If you're interested in more opening credits and motion design and titles, the Art of the Title is a wonderful site. We'll include a link to this on the episode page as well. And in learning about the 6 Feet Under, and I'm sure the Art of the Title has some great things to say about Carnival as well.
Oh, I don't doubt it.
I thought the way they expressed it, it didn't sound like industry stuff. It sounded, it was very poetic. Let me just read sort of a review of 6 Feet Under opening title from Art of the Title. It says, close-up vignettes of bodies. Gruesome and fantastic landscapes mingle with parting hands and familiar metaphors of death and passage as the camera hovers with a gentle curiosity, pausing at times to search the sky for answers. A cold and muted color palette hangs over the sequence and muffles the warm imagery of clasped hands, framed memories, and the living. And yet, despite the presence of death in nearly every frame, beauty and wonder emerge. So I was like, wow, that's a great way to articulate what this little mini movie is doing and sounding like.
Great turn of phrase though, mini movie.
Yeah. I mean, that's really what it is. It's a movie before the movie. And that I think both shows do it really well. I'm going to wrap up by just saying, you know, as someone who has worked in production design and broadcast design, there's always interesting behind the scenes stories that just become more funny, and they become folklore as time goes on because they're captured on film. And Six Feet Under is no different. You know, I mentioned that one of the main characters of the opening scene was the tree, which was, right. you know, dead and propped up with wires. Also, another character of the we keep going back to in the opening sequence is the raven.
Right,
is a symbol for death. And what I learned is that they wanted a crow, but the Danny Yow said that proved to be the most difficult item because they're not legally allowed to film a crow.
Why?
I could not really find the reason. And he says it's weird but true.
Huh.
So what they did is they got a raven on a leash. So, which, like you do, you go get your raven on a leash, and the trainer would just let it fly for these short distances and then bring it back. So that affected the use of it because you just see snippets of this raven mm-hmm. kind of flying across the screen every now and then, or you see it close-ups of its beak or its toes. But the raven probably got the best deal out of all of that. It just had to work probably a few minutes and is eternalized in these opening credits. And he even said in the very first scene where you see it flying across the blank sky, that was just stock footage. That wasn't even the hired raven to do the crow's work.
That's great.
I mentioned that there's a director's cut, and definitely look at that. And chosen for a reason, HBO said we just can't have that amount of work with the animated typography in every episode. And then they made a few other minor changes, but Danny Yout included those in the director's version, which I think are cool. I mentioned there is a scene that anyone who has seen the credits are familiar with, that there's a gurney being pushed down a hallway towards a white light. It's actually being pushed away from a white light and to a white light. That's a kind of key bit of talking about the patriarch of the family in the opening credits. But when they were filming that in Danny Yout's director's cut, he actually uses a scene where he was the person pushing the gurney. It's cut from the final HBO use, but you see it's this kind of dark figure lumbering along. And he said a funny thing about that was the cart handles on the gurney were so low, he had to hunch over and kind of waddle a bit. So it was a little bit like a penguin walk to push this. And it looks, he says, it looks like an old man, which, you know, kind of funny, adds character to it. But, you know, those kind of stories I really love, like about the tree, about the raven, about using the art director as talent. It's things like that when you go back and look at it that makes it a little bit richer for you. And I would say probably since the Carnival credits were not live action, they were all animated, you've got all that richness built from documented footage, from layers and layers and layers of photographs and cards and things. So I imagine at the time, well, there was really nothing else like that. So both of these were really sort of breakthrough. And as mentioned, they both were recognized by the Emmys for their contributions.
Yeah, I mean, I think they definitely raised the bar in terms of not only what could be done, but what was possible in TV film. Hey, Todd, this reminds me, I have a couple of thoughts as we wrap up.
Sure.
So the first thought is, if I were on the set of the Six Feet Under shot, I think I would have named the holly tree Bernie. He's dead.
Bernie?
He's propped up. It's just like one of our favorite movies, Weekend at Bernie's.
We spent the whole weekend shooting this. I think that should be the holly tree's name. You're right.
So, and then my second thought is, I don't know about you, but my glass is empty. And I think it's about time, you know what? I'm feeling rather magnanimous.
You gonna buy?
I'll think about it.
Oh, okay. Well, that's as close as we've gotten so far to, for me getting a free drink. So I'll take you up on that.
All right. Well, let's get to it. And we'll see everyone back around the bar very soon.